contractor for the Beaulieu to Denny overhead piping project. And one of the good benefits for us with regards to this project was that we got to look at some of the more remote sites from over 100 miles from Beaulieu up to Inverness down to Denny West Dublin. And these sites were sites which we thought would never be looked at in terms of archaeology because they were far too remote for any commercial development to go ahead. So the site in question I want to talk about today is based just to the west of Amalie, round about Loch Freakey in Glencraig. And this is just an image that I've taken from the Passmap online facility just to show the amount of archaeology and the history in the region. So across the area there's a number of sites dating from the prehistoric period right through to post-medieval. So we've got the likes of cut-back stones, a couple of possible Iron Age roundhouses. There's a dun canog on the shore of the loch, and although it doesn't stand today, Sheehan Castle probably stood until 1820. As well as this, there's a number of small chapels and holy bells dedicated to a number of saints, St. Elmer and St. Coytag. The area is just littered with archaeology, it's really rich. So the area in which we were most concerned was in the northeastern side of Loch Freakey. This is the 1867 the West map, which just shows the townships along the shores of the loch there. Such as Killoch, west of Killoch, east of Tuareg, just to name a few. It was quite a heavily populated area.
Is it possible to have noise? The screen is washed out by the wet.
So after the 45 rebellion, the land came to the hands of the Marquess of Dalbin, who resided in Teignmouth Castle. And although it was less publicised than some of the other areas in the Highlands, it was heavily affected by the clearances in the 1830s. And the population of the Glen reduced from about 3,500 down to less than 100 people. So much so that there was a good quote, I thought, when the Marquess of Dalbin tried to raise a defensible regiment like his father had done years before. One of the people still residing in the glen told him that he best put the red coats in the back of the sheep that replaced the men, as it was that few left. So the black dotted line here indicates the power line heading through the glen. And sites A to D were all sites that we excavated or partially excavated. The sites A to C were all small parts of small townships which we revealed a series of walls and culverts and so forth. Surfaces. But it was site D that excited us the most, just to the southeast of Kinloch. So this was the second impression, although when we got there it was completely overgrown by ferns and it was really difficult to see. It's tucked away in between two hills. You can see the track, the road just running through here, and judging by the old maps that's still in the same location. So although it's fairly close to that road, or the track, it's still very difficult to see from the track side. So at this point we're really unsure whether it was a thermite from a ceiling or some sort of dry stone game or something like that. So we spent a few weeks cleaning it back, and this is what it revealed. It was a dry stone structure, double skinned walls and a little core, and it was about 7.5 metres approximately diameter externally, about 4.5 metres internally. And you can just make out, it's not the best picture for it, just this bank running up here. It ran up the hillside and connecting to a natural piece of bedrock. And the way that the topography lies means that the water would just flow down the hillside, hit this bank, and then be diverted into the structure, which we thought was really strange because why would you want your structure flooded? It just didn't make sense. Here's the post-excavation plan. So there's the bank that I was speaking about from up here. And in the centre of the area was also a natural spring. So this combined with the water coming out from the hillside and an actual spring. I mean, it must have been wet conditions constantly, and there didn't appear to be any good reason why this would be the case. So they said it was approximately 7.5 to 8 metres in diameter. One of the strange things was there was no entrance. The stone was, a lot of stone had been tumbled from the walls, however there wasn't too much of it lying about, so either this had been rocked, or we suspect that the height of the walls was never actually that tall. There was no evidence of it being roofed, however we think that possibly if it was it could be thatched. I mean, the amount of water that would have been flowing down the hillside, perhaps this has almost just washed all the sediments out. And like I said, it was waterlogged, which we were confused with for months. Directly above the natural spring were six waterborne stones, and also a series of quartz pebbles, rounded quartz pebbles. And as you probably know, these often represent prayer beads or encounters and holy wells. And there's also tales of them having magical powers, either placed at the top of a spring and drinking the water, or to purify the water. As well as this, there's a whetstone found directly in amongst the stones as well. Other than that, there was no evidence to date the site at all. There was no pottery, there was nothing we could get looked at further at all. So, up to this stage, we really had very little else to go on to determine actually what the site was. So these are the waterborne stones that we found. They range in size and shape, some of the bigger ones being sort of anvil-shaped almost, these ones here. Thinking of context, you could say that's an elephant foot for some reason, I don't know why. And there's some sort of dumbbell-shaped ones here. They're obviously waterborne stones. With the way they're formed, there's no working on them to suggest that they were made that way by hand and tool. So at this point we were kind of confused as to what the site was, and we needed some guidance as to where to go with looking into it further. This is where the SCAF project is really good. It tries to plug gaps in the aquatic research like Gavin's mentioning. And we think it's really helpful. It does cover all the periods through the Neolithic up to the post-medieval. But there's also a good one in the carved stones in Scotland. And some of the ideas that it says about suggests to fill the gaps is research in traditional names. So for that, we had a place name study, which we'll come into later, undertaken. We had to look at the folk practices on stones like this, if there was any other stones like this, to see their take on what the folk practices were. And likewise, traditional stories about stones like this, or indeed structures like that, at this point we didn't really know what there was out there. And also suggested the biography of the stones, and by that we mean where did they come from, how were they formed, basically what was the life of the stones after they were deposited there, what happened to them, and up until their death, up until we collected them in the box. So, looking at the research set of questions, we discovered, or we knew of, another site based in Glen Lyon, in Tynemodoc. And there's not a great deal of distance between the two, about 50 kilometres between Tynemodoc and the site at Glen Craig. So, when we were undertaking the research, I got the help of a local volunteer, Steve Ponsonby, who knew of an area in Fortingall, where he'd seen conditions in the rivers there which were ideal for treating these stones. And as well as that, he was aware of a lot of these stones being present in Fortingall on gateposts and around about the village in general. So that was a good starting point. So we visited the site. We managed to locate an area where we think that, I'm not saying the stones were created there, but certainly the type of conditions. And that just helped us to think about where they came from and how they were formed. It may well be that they came from Fortingall. If this is the case, it's almost equidistant between the two sites, so it's quite possible that this could be a good location for where the one originally made. So this is Tynemodoc itself, or sometimes referred to as Tynemodoc, or the House of Carles. And it's located within Glen Craig, translation of Caiaphas, the old woman. Interesting enough, it can also mean land or vale. And the lower part, really the structure that you see there, is located is in Glenmuir. And that would translate to Glenmuir as the same. So the oldest reference that we could find was Duncan Campbell's book in 1888. He suggests there was originally 12 of these carved stones present within the glen. There's certainly no mention of the structure in which they're housed, but he does mention the stones quite in depth. And he suggests that this represents St. Muir and the 11 monks coming into Scotland from the west coast, from Iona, spreading through Scotland, spreading Christianity. And in respect of the monks, these stones were placed within the glen. There's a lot of critics suggest that this is an archaeologist's spin on things, basically, to take away from a pagan belief in it, which I'll come into later, in order to suggest it's a Christian site. Personally, I think I'd really like it to be a pagan site. It's more interesting, I think. So I don't know why people think that we're trying to take away from it. If it was St. Muir, St. Congal would have sent him out from Iona. And this would give us an approximate date, because St. Congal died in 601 or 602, it's kind of clear. So it gives us an approximate date of when these monks may have given to the glen. However, Campbell doesn't really give any good evidence as to why it was St. Muir. He just seems to have plucked his name from the name. So my belief is that this may well have happened, but whether it's St. Muir or not, we're pretty much sure. The structure itself has undertaken a number of rebuilds over the years. The one in the top image here is basically pretty much what it looks like today. I think this was renovated in 2011 by a local stonemason. But the other two images below are just two of the many designs that it's taken over the years. We also know that there was a more pointed roof type temple structure at one point, although I couldn't find a picture of that to show you. So, along with getting a place name study undertaken by Peter McNiven, we tried to determine the most likely route in which these holy men came in from Iona across into England, Scotland, and most likely they've came in from Oban or Loch Awe. And then you can basically split into two different directions. You've kind of got Richard Walker or Timber. And yes, you can go down to Loch Tay, and there probably is numerous other ones, but on the evidence that we researched, this seemed the most likely one. It heads up to Glencaiach through the line, onto Fortingall and into Dull, and as some of you may be aware, there's some excavations and geophysics have been taking place in recent years by Ollie O'Grady, who has shown results that there's certainly a lot of Christian activity taking place in Dull. This is basically following a lot of the routes that Haldane suggests in his book. And there's certainly a route that leads from Kenmore across the Hell Street to Glen Craig. From here, presumably you'd head up to Dunkeld and then anywhere from there. The place name study, we basically got the place name study undertaken on that route, and it did show that within that area, in a kind of buffer zone around about it, there was a lot of older Christian saints referred to in that route. That is interesting in itself, however, we're just unsure that if we widened that area, would it just be that we had the same results for a wider area as well? Unless there was other comparable studies taking place, we can't really say for sure that this is just unique to this one route or not. So, as well as looking at that Christian side of things, we got in touch with a local historian who had correspondence from the estate in where Edinburgh is located. The email they got back from the estate years ago suggests that the structure was actually built in 1956. The this certainly is kind of backed up by the 1950s OS map, because there's no indication of the structure on that map. They tell us that the stones were kept in a shed for a number of years before that, on the estate itself. And in all likelihood, they think that Bob Bissett, who's the gentleman you see in both the pictures, may well have created the structure to bring some more interest into the glen and to the estate. Speaking to some people who knew him and have heard stories about him, apparently he lived on the hillside for days at a time stalking his deer, and often just knock up quick structures or repair shielands and stay in there. So it's not a great stretch of imagination to think of him doing that. There's also a pagan origin to the site. We had a look into the history of this, and it's all basically based on Anne Ross's text from pagan Celtic Britain. And here's the conspiracy to a site on the banks of the Loire in France, where the annual thatching of the roof and taking it off again is compared to what happens at Tyne Bodach, because the stones are put away during the winter months to protect them and shelter them, and then brought back out in the summer. Other than this, we couldn't really find where all this evidence for the pagan thing was coming from. However, if you do a quick search online, everything suggests that this is the case. We did speak to Jess Smith, who's a well-known storyteller within the travel community, and she remembers from her childhood placing milk and wheat cakes around the bow and water, as she calls it, in order to bring to keep away the ill weather and good crops and so forth. However, she can actually remember whether that's 50s or 60s, so I'm not sure. The kayak itself is classic old woman, as I mentioned, is a legend, a well-known legend, especially in Ireland. The Bodach is her husband, and Niamh being her daughter, and the rest of the stones would represent her other children. And one of the legends is that she seeks shelter within the glen of Fort Lyon, and she got shelter amidst this big snowstorm, basically. And this structure and the stones are meant to represent her receiving shelter and bringing good fortune for the crops and so forth. And one of the other legends is that the kayak has to return to the water every 100 years to regain her youth. This is quite telling. When you look at the bottom image here, that's taken from the site we had at Lyon Creek. The structure's not too far from the water. You can imagine her just talking down the hill every 100 years just to regain her youth. And also this might be appropriate with the natural spring that was there. There's some significance to water and the kayak in general. The inhabitants of Kinloch must have known it was there. We found the redstone within there, and I don't believe for a second that they never stumbled upon this. They must have at some point. But the question is, why did they leave it alone? Was it just that this was something that they believed was an older ritual, a pagan ritual, and wanted to stay away from it, and were a bit scared to go near it? Or did it still hold some significance to them? Was it still a respect of the Christianity and being spread through that region? And does our results alter the theory on Tyne Bodach? I think that it certainly shows that it's not just a one-off, but we know it's not just a one-off. The stones are very similar in shape and size. And the important question that we think needs answered is how many more of these structures are out there in the glens of Scotland, which have just been passed by as possible dry stone pens or shield type structures.